Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Nyala karish nua mort, kayen karek nijabuja. We acknowledge the Noongar people as the original custodians of this land. The Lord be with you. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, confident in God's forgiveness. Merciful God,
Almighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in faith, pardon you and set you free from all your sins, strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you. Let us pray. O God, you give light to the blind and comfort to the sorrowing. And in your Son you have given us a high priest who has offered the true sacrifice for us, and yet can sympathize with us in our weakness. Hear the cry of your people and lead us home to our true country, where with your Son and Holy Spirit you live and reign, one glory, one God in glory everlasting. Amen.
A reading from the book of Job. Then Job answered the Lord, I know that you can do all things, and that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. Who is this that hides counsel without knowledge? Therefore I have uttered what I did not understand, things too wonderful for me which I did not know. Hear, and I will speak. I will question you, and you declare to me. I had heard of you by the hearing of the ear, but now my eye sees you. Therefore I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes. And the Lord restored the fortunes of Job when he had prayed for his friends. And the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. Then there came to him all his brothers and sisters and all who had known him before. And they ate bread with him in his house. They showed him sympathy and comforted him for all the evil that the Lord had brought upon him. And each of them gave him a piece of money and a gold ring. The Lord blessed the latter days of Job more than his beginning, and he had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, 1,000 yoke of oxen, and 1,000 donkeys. He also had 7 sons and 3 daughters. He named the first Jemima, the second Keziah, and the third Keren Hapuk. In all the land there were no women as beautiful as Job's daughters, and their father gave them an inheritance along with their brothers. After this, Job lived for 140 years and saw his children and his children's children, 4 generations. And Job died, old and full of days. Hear the word of the Lord.
Unto the Lord. His praise shall ever be in my mouth. My soul shall make a boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. For praise the Lord with magnify his name together. I sought the Lord, and he heard me. Yea, he delivered me out of all my fear. They had an eye unto him, and were lightened, and their faces were not ashamed. Lo, the poor crieth, and the Lord heareth him.
reading from the letter to the Hebrews. This priest that arises according to the order of Melchizedek became a priest with an oath because of the one who said to him, "The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever." Accordingly, Jesus has also become the guarantee of a better covenant. Furthermore, the former priests were many in number because they were prevented by death from continuing in office, but he holds his priesthood permanently because he continues forever. Consequently, he is able for all time to save those who approach God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. For it was fitting that we should have such a high priest, holy, blameless, undefiled, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. Unlike the other high priests, he has no need to offer sacrifices day after day, first for his own sins and then for those of the people. This he did once for all when he offered himself. For the law appoints a high priest those who are subject to weakness, but the word of the oath, which came later than the law, appoints a son who has been made perfect forever. Hear the word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Jesus and his disciples came to Jericho. As he and his disciples and a large crowd were leaving Jericho, Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, a blind beggar, was sitting by the roadside. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout out and say, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Many sternly ordered him to be quiet, but he cried out even more loudly, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stood still and said, "Call him here." And they called the blind man, saying to him, "Take heart, get up, he is calling you." So throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. Then Jesus said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" The blind man said to him, "My teacher, let me see again." Jesus said to him, "Go, your faith has made you well." Immediately, he regained his sight and followed him on the way. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In the name of the living God, life and bread and breath. Amen. So much scripture, so little time. And of course, my particular reason for preaching today, it's commitment time for cathedral regulars and maybe some newcomers and visitors. What are we going to decide about our money? On the subject of giving, the first thing I want to say is thank you. Thank you because you are already giving your money to God. Your giving matters to the cathedral's mission and to your spiritual health. I'll come back to that shortly. But first I want to talk about the book of Job. I don't often preach on Job, he's tricky. The book is 42 chapters long. It starts and ends with storytelling, and in between, vast expanses of sublime poetry. Today, we heard the last of the poetry where Job admits he's both awestruck and dumbstruck. Then in the final bit of storytelling, Job gets a happy ending. The book of Job, annoyingly, manages both to undermine and to reinforce the popular religious idea that if I am good, God will make me prosper. If I am good, God pretty much owes me. The storyteller begins by stressing that Job was good, exceptionally good, and God had indeed made him prosper. But enter the adversary, also known as Satan. God allows the adversary to strip away all Job's prosperity, his children, his workforce, all his assets, and even his health. That's when the poetry starts. Job poetically wishes he'd never been born. He stands by his track record of having been a good bloke who doesn't deserve punishment. He hammers away at the why. Why am I suffering like this? Job's friends trot out the usual slick and unsatisfactory answers. You're not really as good as you think you are. You deserve a bit of suffering. Suffering can make you a better person. Job is not convinced. He argues back to his friends, and most importantly, he keeps talking to God, raging, complaining, questioning. Eventually, God talks back to Job. The poetry is beautiful, but it's still troubling. God questions Job. "Do you understand how the universe works?" how it's been created, the sky, the land, the ocean, the wild animals. Do you know how I do my work? And Job has to admit that, no, he does not know God's cosmic ways. In today's final bit of the poetry, Job says, I'm finally seeing what previously I'd only heard about. God is absolutely, awesomely different. And Job is reduced to awestruck silence. There the poetry stops. After that poetry, anyone who still believes that if I am good, God owes it to me to make me prosper, should also be reduced to awestruck silence. Good behaviour and riches do not correlate. But wait, the storyteller picks up again, and can you believe it? Reinstates the correlation. God makes poor old Job rich old Job again, happily ever after. Don't let anyone ever tell you the Bible is a lovely, simple, easily understandable book. The Bible is, of course, a collection of books with many different theological angles. As Christians, we measure all the different biblical angles, the poetry, the storytelling, the laws. We measure them all against the teaching of Jesus. And Jesus has a lot to say about wealth, none of it positive. Jesus says, if you're rich, it's really hard to be good. Not impossible, because with God all things are possible, but really, really hard. Jesus says, in words of one syllable, woe to you who are rich. Jesus says, don't store up treasures on earth. Don't even try to be rich. To a chap we heard about 2 weeks ago, a good commandment-keeping type of chap who happens to be rich, Jesus says, sell everything, give it to the poor, and follow me. But he doesn't. He just can't. Eventually, Jesus himself dies penniless, stripped of everything. Unlike the book of Job, the Gospels fatally and permanently undermine the idea that if I am good, God will make me rich. Today's Gospel reading was not about a rich man, but about a blind beggar, Bartimaeus. Bartimaeus shouts for mercy until he gets Jesus' attention. When Jesus asks him, what do you want me to do for you? He doesn't ask for eternal life, let alone a seat at Jesus' right or left hand, like James and John did a few verses earlier. Bartimaeus goes straight to his heart's desire. I want to see again. And then, in his gratitude, he gets up and follows Jesus on the way. When Jesus asks us, what do you want me to do for you? What do we say? For many of us who are relatively well off, that can be a difficult question. We may duck it by saying there's always someone worse off than we are. If we're compassionate types, our hearts ache for the refugees, the people with disabilities, the girls denied an education, the women abused and controlled by their partners, the First Nations people living with centuries of dispossession, the queer kids figuring out who they are, the planet heating up and the species dying out, the homeless of our city. I hope and pray we act and advocate for them energetically as part of the Cathedral's mission to this city. Compassion for others is important. And so is not overinflating our own needs compared with other people's. But Jesus still asks us, so, What do you want me to do for you? I encourage each of you to sit with that question this week. Sit with it until your honest answers begin to surface. What mercy has Jesus shown me already? And what do I want Jesus to do for me now? What is my heart's desire? Maybe restore my health or my relationship? Give me a purpose? Lift this burden of shame? Soften my heart for that person? Strengthen my willpower in this challenge? Set me free from that obsession? Save me from this particular time of trial? Pray better, fear less, love more? What do I want Jesus to do for me? And here's the thing. A deep truth about our spiritual life is the way we oscillate between yearning and asking for Jesus to give us our heart's desire and gratitude and joy about the mercy God has already shown us. Bartimaeus was a beggar. In his gratitude for Jesus giving him his heart's desire, Bartimaeus had nothing to give except to follow Jesus on the way. But the likes of us have important decisions to make about what to hang on to and what to give in our gratitude as we follow Jesus. Our relationship with money is central, not incidental, to being a follower of Jesus and to our spiritual health. With our physical health, we know what to do, and it's not eat this superfood, buy this fitness tracker, watch this motivational video. It's not rocket science. It's eat better, move more. Drink less grog, eat more veggies, get more sleep. Connect more with other people because loneliness is just as bad for your health as too many fried foods. There are no guarantees, of course. We can do all the right physical things, and our bodies can still toss a heart attack at us, a blood clot, a cancer diagnosis, an infection, an accident or injury. But that's no reason not to do the blindingly obvious. Move more, eat better, act, belong, commit. We also know what to do for our spiritual health as followers of Jesus. This is not rocket science either. Hang out lovingly with God more often, pray more deeply, serve more humbly, and give our money more generously. Give early, off the top of our income, not from what's left at the end of the week or the month. Give systematically, as a basic discipline, not just when the feeling of generosity comes over us. Give substantially according to our income. Another saying of Jesus, of those to whom much has been given, much will be required. Giving our money is central, not incidental, to our spiritual health. It's a no-brainer. So I encourage each of you to figure out a percentage of your income and give it. After I've done my tax return and found out what my taxable income actually was for last year, 10% is really easy to calculate. You just move the decimal point. If you have a little, give cheerfully from that little. If you have abundance, give cheerfully from that abundance. Among the Anglican followers of Jesus, I know people in their 80s who live purely on the age pension and who give 10% of that every week in their offering envelope without fail. I know better off people who also give with counterculturally ridiculous generosity. Working families with mortgages and school-aged children, independent professionals, self-funded retirees. I also know people in every life situation who give a bit here and there, every now and again. Wherever you are now in that spectrum of gratitude and giving, I say to you, thank you. And for your spiritual sake and for our collective mission's sake, as you follow Jesus on the way, how can you stretch? What about a stretch from occasional to systematic giving, electronically or into an offering envelope? What about a stretch from a random amount, or maybe a preset click and tap and go, to a percentage of your income? If you already give a percentage, how about stretching it to a more adventurous percentage? This week, I invite you to pray and act on the question, how will I stretch? There are no spiritual health guarantees, of course. We can do all the right spiritual things, including giving with joyful extravagance. And we will still have times of darkness in our lives and doubt about our faith. We'll still have strain in our human relationships and frustration with the church. But that's no reason not to do the blindingly obvious. Give generously, give systematically, give cheerfully. Belong, believe, commit. I leave you with a personal observation. When it comes to eating differently and moving more and all those other physical health choices, I have to make those difficult decisions a dozen times a day. It's not easy, witness my waistline. But when it comes to my spiritual health decision about what I give, I only have to make that choice once a year. I make my commitment, I set it up online, and off the money goes where God and the church can use it to make a difference in the world. I find that liberating. Over the many years I've been doing it, giving has become easier and more liberating and definitely more joyful. May all our giving make that kind of difference in our own spiritual lives, in this city that this cathedral serves, and in the whole wide world that God loves. A difference of gratitude, a difference for freedom, a difference for joy.
Let us together affirm the faith of the Church. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
With confidence and faith, let us pray to the Lord. Almighty God, you command us to love one another and to live in harmony. Grant us peace in the world. We pray for the leaders of the nations and all those in authority, especially our Prime Minister, Scott Morrison, opposition leader, Anthony Albanese, and all who govern. Guide them with your wisdom and power so that everyone can live in peace and mutual trust, sharing with justice the resources of the earth. Lord of grace, hear our prayer. God of every time and place, you have called people down the ages to be the bearers of your love, proclaimers of your justice, witnesses of your mercy, and builders of your peace. As we observe United Nations Day, fill us with hope and joy as we look to a new outpouring of your spirit within and among us. Lord of grace, hear our prayer. Loving God, protect those affected by the pandemic around the world, and especially those still in and those transitioning out of lockdowns in New South Wales, Victoria, and the Australian Capital Territory. Continue to strengthen and guide doctors, nurses, and healthcare providers. Bless the sick and all those who care for them. Bless communities in need with the access to vaccinations and medical resources. Lord of grace, hear your prayer. Loving Creator, we ask you to look upon your church with favor and compassion as it works to fulfill your mission. We pray for Kay, our Archbishop, for Assistant Bishops Jeremy and Kate, and all clergy and people. We pray for the Dean and the chapter in their search for a new presenter. Bless our planned giving program and our future plans for this cathedral's mission. For all things come from you, and of your own do we give to you. Form us into humble messengers of Christ's gospel of faith, hope, and love. Lord of grace, hear our prayer. Compassionate God, your love for us is revealed in Jesus Christ, whose earthly life began in poverty and ended in the pain and isolation of the cross. We bring before you those who are homeless. Comfort them in spirit. Provide for their physical needs and sustain the agencies that provide for them. We give thanks and pray for the work of St. Bart's, Anglican WA, The Beacon, Shelter WA, Perth Homeless Support Group, Mission Australia, and every charity that supports the homeless. Lord of grace, all embracing God, we commend to your loving care those who are in need, sorrow, distress, sickness, or suffering. Especially we bring before you today Darren, Percy, Mila, Daryl, Mark, Rose, Graham and family, Sandeep, Sandra and family, Patricia, Adrian, and all those on our hearts this morning. Give to those who care for them wisdom, patience, and gentleness, and to us all, your peace. We pray that the lost will be found, especially Claire Smith, that those in danger will be protected, and that those who mourn will be comforted. Lord of grace, we praise you, Lord, for the communion of saints and for the glorious hope of the resurrection to eternal life. We give you thanks for the life of Olive Sinclair and Sheila Kingshott, recently departed, and Judy Green, Edna Wally, Hilda Peace, Bruce Bengley, Charmaine Dragoon, Chris Amor, and Karen Atkins, whose years mind occur at this time. Bring us all into the joy of your eternal kingdom. Almighty God, you have promised to hear our prayers. Grant that what we have asked in faith, we may by your grace receive through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
We are the body of Christ. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Thank you.
up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
O glory and honor be yours always and everywhere. Mighty Creator, ever-living God, we give you thanks and praise for our Savior, Jesus Christ, who by the power of your Spirit was born of Mary and lived as one of us. By his death on the cross and rising to new life, he offered the one true sacrifice for sin, and obtain an eternal deliverance for his people. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying,
thank you.
Holy God, we thank you for these gifts of your creation, this bread and wine, and we pray that we who eat and drink them in obedience to our Saviour Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, may be partakers of his body and blood, and be made one with him and with each other in peace and love. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and when he had given you thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup, and again, giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this, as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Therefore, we do as our Saviour has commanded, proclaiming his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again. We celebrate with this bread and this cup his one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world.
Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
As we eat and drink this holy sacrament, renew us by your Spirit, that we may be united in the body of your Son, and serve you as a royal priesthood in the joy of your eternal kingdom. Receive our praises, Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we worship you in songs of never-ending praise. As our Saviour Christ has taught us, we are confident to pray, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen." As this broken bread was once many grains, which have been gathered together and made one bread, so may your church be gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom. Thank you. the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, let us take this holy sacrament of the body and blood of Christ in remembrance that he died for us and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Let us pray. Bountiful God, at this table you graciously feed us with the bread of life and the cup of eternal salvation. May we who have reached out our hands to receive this sacrament be strengthened in your service. We who have sung your praises tell of your glory and truth in our lives. We who have seen the greatness of your love see you face to face in your kingdom and come to worship you with all your saints forever. Most loving God, you send us into the world you love. Give us grace to go thankfully and with courage in the power of your Spirit.
The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.